Hello everyone, this is Ross Raddi and welcome to another episode of Fruit Talk. This is the podcast style video that I do for you guys every Wednesday night at 9 o'clock Eastern. We talk a lot about fruits and a lot about vegetables and really how to use all that stuff in the kitchen. In fact, next week's episode, we're going to have a whole episode just involving the kitchen with my buddy Dom, who's also into gardening and also loves to cook things in the kitchen. But we also talk about in Fruit Talk how to grow these weird and interesting fruits that you guys probably haven't heard of that can really impact your taste buds, give you guys a great experience. And one of those fruits I love to talk about and I love to grow is the fig. In tonight's episode, we're going to be talking a lot about keeping your fig tree small. So we had a recent question that came in from one of my Patreon subscribers. This is something that I offer all my Patreon subscribers, is that you can go down to the personalized questions answered tier on patreon.com/RossRaddi. And you'll see down here on this tier, essentially, that I'll answer personalized questions for you. You can send me an email. I get a lot of questions as it is and a lot of YouTube comments as it is, and I think it's just a lot of work and it's becoming very overwhelming. So this is one way I think a lot of you guys who need the help and want the help and can greatly benefit can get it. It's going to be more personalized, more in depth. I'm going to take more of my time with it for these people. Whereas everybody else, unfortunately, it's kind of as short and sweet as I can make it, because it really is overwhelming and it really is a lot of work. And if you know you are a Patreon subscriber, I greatly appreciate it. I don't really like to ask too much for support, but I truly believe that by supporting me on Patreon and just watching my videos, it kind of pays for itself, because I offer you guys so much information, so much content, that I really do believe I save a lot of you guys a lot of time and a lot of money. So personally, I think it pays for itself. Do what you will with it, but Vincent here, he put this question in through email, and I'm going to read it to you guys. So it says, "Hi Ross, thanks for sharing your knowledge of figs and gardening freely. I'm more than happy to support your work, even if you didn't offer advice. Short version of the question, how would you prune this 2-year-old Celeste fig that's in ground in zone 8A that gets a solid seven hours of sun per day?" And the long version of the question is that he's in Arlington, Texas, zone 8A. And when you guys are answering any questions or even thinking about what practices or techniques or growing anything, any food at all, it really depends on where you guys live. So I'm really happy that Vincent gave me his location. And if you know anything about Arlington, Texas, we can look at here on Google Maps. And you'll see it's in northeast Texas, and it's near Dallas. And this, to me, if you know anything about the climate in the United States, is that East Texas, all the way through the South, through Louisiana and maybe parts of Arkansas, Mississippi, Alabama, Georgia, the top of Florida, and then all the way up through the Mid-Atlantic on the coast, the East Coast, all the way up to the Northeast. It's a very similar climate, and I don't think a lot of people knew that. I mean, obviously it's very different in terms of temperature. It can be different in terms of the amount of heat and the length of the season, the length of the growing season, but for the most part it's very humid and it's also very stable. We have a very stable climate in the Northeast and the Mid-Atlantic and the South. And you'll see actually in Google Maps here, if I zoom out, or if you zoom out, you can see there's a pretty clear line that separates Texas. And that's really a line of vegetation, a line of desert versus a stable climate. You know, you can definitely see towards like El Paso, it's way more desert-like. But in the west side of Texas, it's just a lot more dry. So knowing this, and knowing that Vincent lives in a very humid climate, in fact, he gets 40 inches of rain annually, which is quite a bit. That's actually pretty much the same amount of rain that I get in Philadelphia. So what I'm about to tell you guys is really based off of my experience as someone in Pennsylvania and someone in Philadelphia, and how that translates to a lot of you guys in those particular places that I mentioned. If I lived in a dry climate like West Texas, this would be a totally different answer. So it's important really to consider these differences, guys, when you're growing and when you're giving people advice. So yeah, okay, so go back to the question here. He says, Vincent says he has a clay alkaline soil, and he's keeping he's doing a deep mulch to amend the soil. He's got 30 or so trees in a suburban front or backyard. Stone fruits, pears, apples, persimmons, olives, pomegranates, jujubes, mulberries. And it's 2 years old. He's pruning everything to keep things short, and he is still waiting for meaningful fruit production, but he's hoping he's going to get some fruit in 2020. I have two Celeste figs and an LSU purple that's in the ground, but he actually has an LSU gold, not an LSU purple, he later told me in another email. He says this is their second spring, and the LSU gold in full sun gave him three delicious figs. The Celestes are producing, but he thinks he has a sun problem. Watching your video and pinching, I think it helped, but I did it a bit late. 40 figs are going to freeze in 2 or 3 weeks, so the Celeste count for him this year is zero. The Celeste above is partially a windbreak for some apples, but he liked to taste some fruit someday. I was leaving it in a bush form, thinking it may help it survive the winter, but he realized that his lows are 20 degrees for only a few days at a time, and he may be fine for that either way. Would you limit up, pinch it early, or leave it be? It's 4 feet tall, and I aim to keep it under 8 feet. I am ground layering the lowest branch and will replant in full sun on a southern exposure in early spring. Appreciate any advice you can give. You can draw cuts on the photos if it helps. Keep up the great work, Vincent. So that's a nice email, Vincent. Thanks for asking it, because it definitely can help a lot of people here. And you can see down further down in the email, he's got some photos of his tree. He says it's Celeste. It's 4 feet tall. It looks a bit taller than 4 feet, but, you know. I'll also say that looking at this tree, this is not a Celeste. To me, it looks more like a Hardy Chicago. And they're easily mixed up depending on where you got them. They usually carry Celeste. They usually carry Hardy Chicago. The leaves look the same or similar. But judging from these leaves, it looks more like a Hardy Chicago. In fact, I'd be very shocked if this was a Celeste. It doesn't have Celeste-like leaves. Celeste normally has, you know, three-lobed leaves. Sometimes you'll get some five. Sometimes you may even get some one-lobed leaves, but for most part, it's three. This tree's showing five. It has that typical Hardy Chicago look to it. So, Vincent, you got a better fig here, actually. You got a better fig. You got probably the best fig you can ask for. Maybe even in existence. I'm not going to lie. In a climate, it's so widely adapted, and especially in a humid climate, it's like the best fig, I'm telling you. Really underrated, fantastic flavor. So let's get kind of started here into some advice. First off, the thing I've noticed else in this photo, by the way, is that you have a lot of mulch, and you weren't kidding by a deep mulch. This is not what you want for a fig. If your fig tree, for anyone out there, if your fig tree is not fruiting and your season's not too long, too incredibly long, you know, if your season's, let's say, 210 days. You have 210 frost-free days, or lower, and your tree is not fruiting, I would very strongly suggest looking at the soil and looking at what's on top of the soil. If you have a cool soil, which is what mulch does, mulch cools down the soil, the metabolisms of the trees slow down. And these are not, fig trees are not temperate fruits. Even though we are growing them in a temperate zone, even in East Texas, it's still temperate there. We can get away with it and grow figs because, you know, figs are incredible, but, you know, they're not something like the other fruits you're growing, like stone fruits and apples and pears. These are not fruits that you really want to cool the soil down on. You know, your things like your persimmons, your olives, your pomegranates, your jujubes, your mulberries. Maybe not the mulberry. That's a bit debatable because, you know, there is, depends on the type of mulberry you have, but, and the figs as well. You don't want to be cooling the soil. You want to be giving them as much heat as humanly possible. They are trees that, without a doubt, just need more heat. And you're not going to have that same metabolism that you'd have with a stone fruit. So, give you an example, bugs, insects, right? They're cold-blooded, right? So they only perform, that's why there's no bugs in the wintertime, because when it's too cold, they're not active. They can't really move. When it's warm, they're very active. That's why the mosquitoes are crazy in the summertime. They breed. They're more active. It's the same thing with figs. The same thing with even the stone fruits, is that every species of tree has the optimal soil temperature for them to perform at their optimal performance, I guess. It's not really the best way, the best phrase, but that's really how it is. And if you don't have the right soil temperature, your tree is at a detriment. Your tree is not performing at the level it should. And that's why your Celeste is not fruiting, or it's putting on fruit too late. And that's why your Celeste has zero figs on it. And that's why your LSU Gold only has 3 figs on it. It really has nothing to do with the sun. The sun, well, not that it has nothing to do with the sun. The sun's great, right? The more sun, the better. But certainly in 7 hours of light in Arlington, Texas, you should be all right, man. Even in 6 hours of light here in Pennsylvania, we're good. On the west side of my house, in 6 hours of light, we're still getting some good fruit production. So it's not really the sun that's the issue. Of course, sun is going to give them more photosynthesis, more energy. You're going to have a warmer soil, but it's not necessary. Really, the warmer soil is going to be king here. So not only does this translate into, first off, this eliminates all your issues, right? This actually eliminates every single issue you have. In terms of, you mentioned, you know, not getting fruit, or getting fruit too late, keeping your tree small, those are your two biggest issues right there, and everything is solved by warming up the soil. Especially when the soil is very warm in the summer, it may even be too warm, and because it's too warm, it actually stops the growth, keeping your tree smaller, which is kind of crazy. And not only does the mulch conserve moisture, we want to be eliminating moisture. We want to be shedding moisture. 40 inches of rain is a lot for a fig. We want somewhere around 20, 25 to have a happy and healthy tree. Anything over that, we're actually getting too much water, which is then translating to too much growth. So by having, believe it or not, a mulch, a covering on the soil that's very deep, you're preventing a lot of that moisture from evaporating back out into the atmosphere, which is good for certain things, right? It's good for building soil. It's good for the earth. It's good for a whole host of different things. But for figs and subtropical trees, in a humid climate, it's not something you want. If I lived in the desert, and I lived in California or even West Texas, Arizona, you know, those are the climates that I would say, all right, well, let's put as much mulch down as humanly possible, because I want to keep as much moisture in the soil so I don't have to water. I want to build a better soil life, and everything would really work itself out and be so much better. You, on the other hand, have clay. You have a really heavy soil. In addition to 40 inches of rain, it's just completely unnecessary for all of your trees, really. For every single one of your fruit trees, it's completely unnecessary. In fact, I'll tell you this, with my persimmon that I built the soil up, mulch upon mulch upon mulch, and different types of mulch, and comfrey, and micronutrients, and this and that, I created some incredible topsoil in only 3 or 4 years underneath my persimmon. My Rosianca persimmon in the front of my house is now 20 feet tall. It's in its fourth year. It's a huge tree. And guess how many fruits I've gotten off of it? 10. And there's just the simple truth of years of learning how to grow fruit trees right there in a nutshell. In that, especially with these subtropical trees, guys. You know, maybe you can get away with it more with the stone fruits and the pears and the apples, but it's still the same principles. More growth, more fertility, more water is going to essentially net you a bigger tree with less fruit and less tasty fruit. More water is going to lower the bricks. So essentially, you are really asking the right question here, because this is really going to tell you pretty much everything about growing fruit trees. So you don't want to be feeding your fig. You don't want to be watering your fig. You don't want to be covering the soil. What you do want to do is probably cover the soil just with one layer of rocks. I find it gives a nice benefit of one covering the soil, which has a great number of benefits to it. Just by covering the soil with something really helps for that soil life, for that mycorrhizae, for all that soil building goodness, all that great things that come in the soil, that will be there just by covering it with something. But if you cover it with rocks instead of mulch, and just one layer of rock, because if you get too deep with stones and too deep with gravel, as an example, you're then counteracting the effects. You really want one layer, because that's going to net you the most soil temperatures. That's going to get you a warmer soil. Mulch is going to cool the soil. Rocks are going to heat the soil. Even better than that would be like plastic, black greenhouse plastic you can lay down on top of the soil. That's probably the best of everything for all these subtropical trees. I personally like the mulch for the stone fruits, the pears, the apples, because they don't need those warmer soil temperatures. They don't want that. What they do want is less water, but we are going to cover the soil, but we're going to cover it with mulch, and not a whole lot of mulch, just enough so that it breaks down. It's doing something for the trees, but it's not giving them so much nutrients that I'm building 4 inches of topsoil. You know what I mean? And of course, we're giving them all that benefits of covering the soil. So there's a big difference there. And I think it's very easy to correct and keep things like apples and pears, even some stone fruits a bit smaller, you know, things that may have spurs. You know, there's very obvious pruning techniques for keeping those trees small. When you get into things like your pomegranates, your persimmons, your jujubes, your mulberries are a bit easy, actually. The mulberry, you kind of just want to prune out all the vertical growth. I'd probably say that the same thing for the persimmon, is that you're going to get a lot of limbs that are going horizontally, or you're going to get a lot of limbs that are going actually down towards the ground. Keep all that and prune out all the growth that's growing straight up. All that growth that grows straight up, it doesn't fruit a whole lot anyway. You know, with the fig, it's its own little animal because it fruits on the new growth. So you need actually a vigorous, healthy, almost upward growing growth. Not totally straight up in the air, but definitely on some nice angle here, like a 75, 65 degree angle. You know, that's going to get you vigorous growth, but also growth that's going to fruit. So it's important, you know, imagine that in your mind when you visualize the tree and say, all right, well, what is growing straight up in the air? Let's get rid of that, you know. Keep the stuff that's growing more horizontally or even towards the ground. And if in the case of the fig, you don't really want anything growing towards the ground, I find. That stuff won't fruit. You're not going to get the vigorous growth you want. And it's just you know, basically something that is not going to do anything for you. In terms of your shape of the tree, you know, it's really simple. Just decide between a bush or a tree. A bush is great for people who are in very cold climates. 20 degrees at the low seems very high for a zone 8A. I think that's more like zone 8B. Because here in zone 7A, we get to 0 to 5 degrees. Zone 7B would be 5 to 10 degrees. And then 8A would be from 10 to 15 degrees. So if you're in 8A, Vincent, you can actually get down to 10 degrees Fahrenheit, which actually isn't that bad for a fig. 10 degrees is not really the biggest thing to worry about. In fact, you'll be totally fine with a Hardy Chicago at 10 degrees, even a Celeste, even an LSU Gold, even an LSU Purple, whatever it is that you got. You'll be totally all right. So you could keep them as a tree, and a tree is going to net you something that's more productive. It's going to be easier probably to control the size of it. However, you could also do it pretty well with a bush. It's just going to be, I think, a bit more work to control it, to tame it. With a tree, it's pretty simple, right? We're taking out a lot of that growth that's growing straight up in the air, 90 degree angles. You know, we're taking out growth that's growing straight down as well, or growing, you know, downwards. We're taking out the growth. We're first setting up, by the way, I should get into this. We're setting up the right form with a tree. You want to have a lower scaffolding structure. And here's the scaffolds right here as a visual. In that we take off the apical bud, the tip, the top of the tree. You know, this is normally what happens with figs, is that they don't really have a straight up in the air trunk, as most trees are, kind of like this. I forget what the exact name is. A central leader, that's what it's called. Figs don't really have too many, a central leader. They have many central leaders, and they end up forming a canopy that's more rounded, a big crown. Whereas a normal tree, like let's say a maple or an oak, is going to put out a big central leader. And from that central leader, it's going to put out these arms. And it's going to keep that central leader for probably a long time until something happens to it. Whereas a fig, as an example, you know, we're going to get rid of that central leader quite quick, and it's going to form this very big canopy just like this. This is really pretty accurate right here. So as a tree form, we want to get this rounded canopy lower. You can see on this diagram, this looks like 28 inches, I think, is kind of what they're saying. But you really want to cut this down. You want this branching to form at knee height. So your knee is probably what, like 15 inches off the ground? And that's what a lot of people recommend for backyard growers, like Tom Spellman, Dave Wilson Nursery. That's what they always talk about. It's really beneficial, and I wish some of my trees, I had originally purposed them for growing them in pots, and now they have a different form to them, and I wasn't too worried about how big they'd get. And now I planted them in the ground, and they're going to be pretty big trees. So it's important to kind of do this now, early. And it's the same thing with a fig. If you're doing it as a tree, cut it off at knee height. You're going to induce that scaffolding a lot lower. Here's what the scaffolding looks like, right? We remove the central leader up here, which then gets this scaffolding branch's dominance. We form permanent branches, permanent systems that are away from each other. This is a really good picture right here. And that if this is the top of the tree, we have a permanent scaffold here, 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 and there, in a star formation. And they're all very far away from each other. You could select maybe 6 scaffolds, 4, 5, 3. It's up to you, however you'd like to shape your tree. But the idea here is that you're going to keep these scaffolds in a permanent setting, and you want them low. Maybe even for a fig, you could even get them, you know, 6 inches off the ground. At least started 6 inches off the ground. This is really important for keeping your tree small, is getting that permanent structure. It doesn't matter if it's a bush or if it's a tree. A bush is just going to have you more trunks from the base. But you, those trunks from the base are pretty much acting as scaffolds, right? What I would suggest is limiting the number of trunks from the base to about 6, probably limiting the number of scaffolds to about 6 if it's a tree, and making sure from there you're getting that appropriate branching that you want, you know, something like this, and getting that branching, that structure that you're looking for. And that's kind of it. You know, every year you're going to come back and you're going to see your tree, and you're going to see your tree get evolve and get older and more form to it, and it's going to be a work in progress every year, and everything's going to be different every year. But really, it's as simple as getting the right form from the beginning, taking out a lot of that growth that is maybe crisscrossed, shading each other out, dead, diseased, damaged. Maybe it has a lot of FMV, maybe a lot of the growth in a particular portion of the tree is actually not showing that much vigor to it. Cut that out, do some renewal process. But for the most part, you want to limit the pruning to a minimum. And here's the other key here, because we mentioned the soil and how important that is, right? Lack of nutrients, lack of water. Those are really important for keeping your tree smaller. Less fertility in the soil, a hotter soil. Once you get over like 95 degrees Fahrenheit at the soil level, you actually will have a complete stop of growth. But one thing we didn't really mention, and this kind of comes in with pruning, is that you're going to get yourself the right hormonal balance. And this is really tricky, and a lot of people don't understand this. I still don't really fully understand it, but I've experienced it enough to really say to myself, all right, well, here's the basics. And the basics are pretty much that if you prune your tree too much, the tree will respond by putting out lots of growth the following year. That's just how fig trees work, and most trees work. You know, there's a hormone, auxin, and there's the cytokines, if I'm pronouncing that right. And there's another hormone. The three hormones kind of all work together in symbiosis. And there needs to be the right balance of these hormones, just like us in our brain. We have a certain balance of hormones. If we have one hormone that's too much, we're going to have too much growth. If we have another hormone that's too much, we might have too much root growth and not enough vegetative growth. You know, it's the right balance that needs to happen. So if we prune too much, we're actually throwing the tree off, and we're getting a lot of growth that then actually puts out very little fruit. And here's the other caveat, is that not only do we need to have the right hormonal balance, we need to have the right balance of growth to fruit. If we have too much growth, we won't get fruit, and we're just going to have more growth because of it as a result. If we had a lot of fruit, that will actually slow down the vigor of the tree. So it's really tricky, unfortunately, and this really only comes with experience. But I will tell you this, if you prune your tree too much, you're you're putting yourself at a detriment. You're hurting yourself. Get the right form from the beginning. You know, you can keep this tree at about 5 or 6 feet. You know, maybe get that permanent structure somewhere around the 4 feet area, and then every year it could grow instead of keeping it like 4 feet as the base structure. It would probably get to about 8 feet, and then every year bring it back down just ever so slightly. Come in here, and what you want to do is take out some of these branches that are in the middle. You have three branches as an example. Take out the one in the middle. We can't really do that with my fingers. Yeah, this is not really working. How about that? That's a better one. There you go. Take out the one in the middle. And take out the entire length of the branch. Instead of taking out a third of the growth everywhere, take out an entire length of branch. This is something I think is really going to help keep that hormonal balance in check. Rather than heading all the branches, just take an entire system out. You know, and if you have to take out, let's say, an entire scaffold, you could do that too, right? I'd rather take out an entire system of branches than cutting all the branches. You know, I think that really hurts the hormonal balance of the tree. By cutting out and reducing the height of all the branches, you're throwing your tree into a weird state hormonally. So I think that's really the biggest tips here. Yeah, we're going to show you guys more about pruning. We just did do a pruning video, like a little preview on these trees. Unfortunately, I don't have an in-ground tree that I could really show you the right way to prune it, but I will. I'll show you what it looks like at least at a younger stage. If I maybe protect one of these trees, excuse me guys, if I can wrap one of them, maybe I'll do that, and then I can show you guys more examples of what a more mature tree in a climate like 8A and how it would look. But my containers are probably the closest thing you're going to get to that tree form, to that form that you want, that is more mature down the road. And we'll look at that. We'll do another video for sure, more in depth in pruning. It's a great question to ask, Vincent. I hope this answered a lot of it for you. I'm sure I gave you great ideas here of some things that you need to do. I'm trying to read through the email here in case there's anything I missed. I wouldn't worry too much about the sun, as I mentioned. I would try to warm up the soil as much as I could. Leaving it bushy or leaving it as a tree, that's up to you. I would pinch it every year. That's really great for that hormonal balance. Pinching will change the auxin and will stop the growth and tell the branches on the tree that you've pinched to fruit. Assuming enough time has gone by, the branches on your trees, those fruiting branches, have reached a state of maturity, and you see those two dots. You see that fruit node and you see the branch node. If you only see one, it's just a branch, it won't be a fig, and your branches, your fruiting branches, have not yet reached maturity. If you can definitely keep it under 8 feet. That's a guarantee if you do this all right. Kind of at the state that it's at right now, I would say that your tree is a bit wild. You don't have the branching at a low enough point. This is a system of branches right here, it seems like. This is too high. This is too high. You want your systems of branches to kind of start down here. If you can get them to branch out here, get those scaffolds formed down here around the 6 inches to 24 inches mark, that's what you want. Eventually around 4 feet tall, somewhere around this area here, you'll get that permanent structure. once you form this permanent structure, including all of your scaffolds, this is where all of your scaffolds should be permanently, you can then get yourself a lot more branches, a very thick, dense, rounded crown canopy of branches in here to select from, to eliminate, to pretty much maintain at a height of about 8 feet. You can do that. Another thing I didn't mention is that we mentioned that pruning, too much pruning, will get you too much growth. And instead of heading back all the branches, cutting out a third of every branch, or even a half of every branch, we should be taking out the entire branch, an entire system of branch, or even just an entire branch, right? So like I said, the, you know, take out the things in the middle, right? And then leave these two. What you should do with these two that you've left is take off the tip of the branch. Take off the tip, that's gonna change off the auxins, it's gonna change up those hormones for the good. And you're then gonna get some growth that's quite vigorous, quite healthy, coming out of these points here, which is gonna grow out this way, it's gonna grow out this way, it's gonna grow out this way, and the same thing with this one, out here, out here, out here, and you're gonna get yourself that dense canopy that you're looking for. That's spaced in a way that's not blocking too much of that sunlight from each other. So that's all it is, really. Pretty simple. Taking off the tips or taking out an entire system of branch to thin out the tree. That's really all you're trying to do. So again, just to recap, we want to eliminate as much water as we can. We don't want to be feeding. We want to have as much warmth and soil temperatures as we can. And we also want to be having the right hormonal balance. That's going to really help keep our tree smaller. So, all right, guys, and Vincent, I want to thank everyone here for watching. We'll talk to you all soon. Hopefully you guys got something out of this. We'll see you for next week's episode of Fruit Talk. Take care, everyone.